that deal, we don't care about us. All credit, no support, no gym, no resources. Hear me, hear what I say. All I wanna say is that deal, we don't care about us. All I wanna say is that deal, we don't care about us.
Our school is not only a school, it's a family.
For the past how long that you've been trying to shut us down, we have put up a fight, and as long as you try to put up a fight with us, we will fight right now.
In 2002, Mayor Michael Bloomberg took control over New York City schools. He argued centralized control was the vital and missing link to improving the city's schools. The 32 elected community school boards were quickly dismantled, and a new organization, the Panel for Educational Policy, was given sole authority over all major educational policy decisions. Bloomberg was allowed to appoint 8 of this panel's 13 voting members. The mayor focused his efforts on increasing accountability and the use of assessment. He created a school grading system and announced plans to shut down schools that struggled rather than providing them with support. Bloomberg has championed this authoritarian approach while ignoring and eliminating the input of New York City citizens. Our country is in the midst of an education reform frenzy. Parents and teachers in New York no longer have a voice in the education conversation, and their plight has become common across the nation. In 2010, movie director Davis Guggenheim's Waiting for Superman opened in theaters nationwide.
We have a crisis in public education in America today.
The film portrayed corporate reformers as the education experts and painted teachers and their unions as the enemy.
This is nothing but the result of the adults in this system not doing their jobs.
The corporate reformers touted in the film believe that charter schools are the magic silver bullets to overcome the challenges facing our education system.
Big supporter of these successful charter schools, and so is the president. And that's why one of our top priorities is a $52 million increase in charter school funding for our FY 2010 budget.
The reformers claim the most important determinant of academic success is the teacher. They intentionally minimize the effects of factors outside school in order to avoid addressing the impact of societal problems on education.
As two people who adored educators and education as children, and as two people collectively with 20 years of teaching experience in the classroom, we are shocked by the tone, the tenor, much less the content of the current so-called reform movement in education. Our collective experience does not show us that placing public services in the hands of private entities, as featured in Waiting for Superman, will solve the problems that we face.
There is no doubt reform is needed, and we have not been waiting. The question is, will those in power listen to the actual stakeholders and take meaningful action?
We wanted to explore the truth about education reform, so we did something shocking. We spoke with parents and educators. Their perspectives shed light on the current movement for education reform, and their perspectives highlight the inconvenient truth behind waiting for Superman.
I became a public school teacher because I believed it was a way to change the world. Growing up, I was what many would have called an invisible child, but I was never invisible to my teachers. They and school were home to me, and I was blessed to have so many amazing educators in my life who consistently encouraged me and mentored me and eventually gently guided me toward the teaching profession. I figured if I could be in the position to pay even a small amount of my great fortune forward, it was my moral imperative to do so, and so I became an educator.
I come from a long line of teachers. I remember going to the 90th birthday party of one of my great aunts in Detroit. There was like 100 people there, and at one point she joked that she had taught most of them. I remember my first day as a teacher, and I thought, wow, this is easy. And after the first week, I didn't think it was so easy. My first years teaching were so hard, so frustrating. When you're doing everything for the first time, every lesson for the first time, it takes so long to plan and prepare, to plan just one day, let alone a whole week or a whole year. And after all those long hours and long nights, you'd get this little bitty paycheck. And I remember thinking, my paycheck doesn't even have a comma in it. Meanwhile, it didn't take long for my rent to have a comma. And then there'd be these other moments where I was like, wow, I can't believe I'm getting paid to do this. I get to meet with these people every day and talk about books and ideas. We get to ponder what's true and not true about the world and ask really big questions like, how do you know?
My school is located in one of the largest housing projects in New York City in Red Hook, Brooklyn. And we have a long history of successfully serving a largely underserved community for years. Our school has consistently been an A school with awards for closing the achievement gap and educating special needs students. I became active in education policy after about 7 years in the classroom. A few years after that, my school was forced to co-locate with a charter school. To have a charter school come into our community and for us to be forced to share our school building with them, where we had to give up space for children with special needs, where my kids were being serviced for speech and occupational therapy in corners and in shared classrooms and in hallways, all for the benefit of a charter school that was started by the Robertson family. Who are billionaires. The father, Julian Robertson, is a hedge funder who has donated millions to our mayor, Mr. Bloomberg's school change initiatives. It was quite shocking, and I think it highlights the insincerity and the cynicism behind this movement. And I had no choice but to stand up with my fellow educators and the parents and the kids that I serve. To protect our school, to protect our children, and to fight for children across the city who we knew would soon face the same fate as our successful public school.
The powers that be in education
really don't seem to care much for the actual experience of teaching. Policy making for them is like launching missiles. They sit far away in some kind of control tower somewhere, and they make decisions about what will be. It's like they push a button and launch a policy missile. It's not about spreading best practices from the classroom outward. At least it doesn't feel that way. It feels like that you're doing your job, and then their job is to drop bombs on you. At least that's part of why I think we see so many teachers leave. And they all started out just like me. They started out in it for the joy of teaching. They left out of frustration.
The business model took this country to the brink of Armageddon in 2008. And yet we want to follow a failed business model and imprint that on top of public education.
In recent years, free market business principles have been taking center stage in our country's education reform debate. More and more of our nation's school districts are being led not by educators, but by lawyers and corporate executives who push accountability and competition as the way to improve our nation's schools. They hold themselves up as education saviors while branding educators as the scapegoats.
I think too often we are coddling our children.
Unless there's accountability, we'll never get the right system.
Accountability. It's accountability.
Focus on accountability.
Accountability. I would urge the federal government not to ratchet down, but to ratchet up accountability.
Anybody that thinks things aren't getting better just isn't being realistic. And all the success flows from the fact that the system now has clear lines of accountability running right up to the mayor.
During his 8 years in total control of New York City schools, Michael Bloomberg has succeeded in transforming 1.1 million school children into numerical data. He was recently exposed for distorting that data in a desperate attempt to show progress for his education reforms, where there was no progress. This has allowed him to continue his plan to deregulate our public school system by closing public schools and replacing them with privately run education corporations.
Thank God for charters. There's no room for innovation in the standard system.
Bill Gates has used his Microsoft billions to finance misguided experiments upon our country's school children. He has manipulated cities and states with the promise of cash into shutting down large public school communities in favor of small schools and charter schools that have largely discriminated against children with special needs and English language learners. Bill Gates continues to impose his uninformed ideas about education upon our public schools.
We don't have music, but there is a new piano upstairs, but it does not belong to Jamaica High School. It belongs to one of the new schools. I have to say, we did get something new. We got new metal detectors outside. Whereas my calculus textbook was copyright 1984.
I am paid to educate a child, whether that mother is deeply engaged or that mother is not. And when we accept this as professionals, then you have to educate everybody.
Jeffrey Canada is the founder and CEO of Harlem Children's Own, which manages hedge fund and billionaire-backed charter schools with over $200 million in assets. In 2007, Mr. Canada was exposed for kicking out an entire class of children from his charter school, Promise Academy 1, because their test scores were too low. To this day, Mr. Canada's two charter schools consistently show high rates of attrition, despite his claims of success.